for the defense. This meant bringing evidence to show the cheek shot had not been the first shot, and any of the other two could have occurred first. In other words, Laniet was still capable of breathing after the two shots that actually hit her brain. As mentioned, the bullet that entered Laniet's upper cheek by her ear had followed a less harmful path than the other two bullets. All the pathologists in the trial agreed Laniet could have continued breathing after the cheek shot, and may even have become conscious. The cheek shot bullet, or fragments of it, went mainly under the brain, and, with the right medical help, Laniet would probably have survived this wound. Crown witness, pathologist Ken Thompson, said he knew of an almost identical case where someone was rendered unconscious by a shot in the location of Laniet's cheek wound and, within a few minutes, sat up and was able to pick up a telephone and dial for help. The other two shots were not survivable and knocked out parts of the brain vital to most of the body's functions, he said. Pathologists agreed Laniet's death would have been quick after the two shots directly hitting the brain, but they disagreed on just how quick. David's case was helped by evidence from defense pathologists, who would not discount the possibility Laniet could have continued breathing for some time even after all three headshots. However, the Crown's three pathology heavyweights were adamant that, barring some freak event, Laniet had been shot in the cheek first. She would have been able to keep breathing and perhaps move her hands towards her wounds, thereby touching blood around her neck area, they believed. Thompson said either of the next two shots had destroyed important structures in the base of the brain and would have been instantly fatal. There are always cases described where people have survived for a surprising length of time after gunshot wounds,